Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Divinity 2 Original Sin. My playthrough of it. I apologize for yesterday. I know yesterday's episode was really, really boring. Not a whole lot of combat to it. Hopefully today is a little bit different. Hopefully today we actually get to a decent amount of combat. So, let's get going.
Yeah.
that actually went a lot easier than I expected it to. Not a bad thing, but I still expected it to be harder.
You are ever sodden, ever sandy. The smell of guts and sea waste cling to you like a ghost. You sought freedom, the life of a seaman, but you didn't find it. Early memories are overshadowed by a terrifying death, a tempest of teeth, scales, and snarls. You never imagined it would end like this.
Something. turns it out.
Come on, you stubborn hunk of garbage.
The dwarf's fingers clamp around a splintered chunk of wood nailed to the skeleton of an old ship. His whole body strains with the effort of wrenching the plank free, to no avail. Ah!
Wouldn't you like to know?
The dwarf spits into each of his calloused palms and rubs them together before placing them both back on the plank and pulling.
Must be charmed or something.
We'll just see about that.
He grabs hold of the plank and hefts his great bulk backward. The rusty nail pops loose, and the dwarf stands back, smiling proudly, his prize in his hands. The plank promptly crumbles to pieces.
Son of a...
Aye, so did I. But a fella's got to try, hasn't he?
He casts one appraising eye over the planks strewn on the ground and those still nailed to the ship. His brow furrows in calculation. He sucks a finger and holds it up to the wind, testing the breeze.
Winds like these, she would have capsized before she reached the break. Well, on to plan B.
He gives you a wry look, as though deciding whether to trust you.
Aye, was planning to build me a raft and paddle off. I've got business north of here, in a town called Driftwood. Far be it from me to miss an appointment. Hold on there, lad. You looking to spend the rest of your days on this island, or do you want to get out? Well now, that makes two of us, doesn't it?
He crosses his great burly arms across his chest and scans you with his good eye.
I reckon. Yep, you'll do. Why don't we make a deal then? You help me get out of this place, and I'll do the same for you. Happy to trundle around with a group of amateurs at your heels, are you? Or not but your own skinny shadow? Your funeral, lad. I'll be here when you change your mind.
Lizard's brow knits together, then apart, and back again. He seems to be swimming deep in his thoughts, and doesn't look up as you approach.
What? Oh, new, are you? Very good, very good. Make yourself at home. Goods? Ah, yes. Yes, of course. Have a look.
Just a quick pause, my daughter is away.
Back.
the goods. That you wanted.
Delivery. Surely you'll have one.
What a crumbling disaster.
Square. Oh, excuse me. I'm very tired. Abominably tired. Beg your pardon.
Keep it there, will ya?
Leave him be. Don't make me say it again.
Listen, I can help you if you just...
Shut up, Elf! This clown caught him stealing from my kitchen. Still won't say where he stashed my supplies. Sound like someone you'd let off with a slap on the wrist. Caught him red-handed trying to make off with a second crate after he took the first. Went down like a rent boy when we grabbed him. Easy. Supplies. Crate of food, citrus in particular. He'll talk, or he'll die quiet. All's I want is my supplies. Happy to let this clown die in a gutter instead of my kitchen. Bring back my crate, and you got yourself a deal.
You are. I wonder what keeps you. Tell me your tale. For I am an elf. The tongue of others is not my tongue. You may speak of then and when. I do not. I refuse to learn their strange speech. Start from the beginning. Start from where you come. I see. Now tell me more. Tell me what you do. Tell me what you find. I understand. Now tell me how your story ends. Ah, you want reunion. Life is lonesome. Yes, life is lonesome. The thing you love is gone. I have something for you, my friend. A gift. We can see the things we lose, not with our eyes, but with our hearts. This ruby does the trick. It is nothing. Many fragments swirl on my shore. See what I gather.
An elf, caked in mud and blood, looks up at you from the bottom of the cage. He holds his shoulder at a strange angle. Despite his condition, he appears eager for your attention.
You believe what he says? That I am a thief?
Perceptive. Like most men behind bars, I'm innocent. Like most of us here on the island, in fact. Aren't you like me, looking for a way out? I do. I prepare it myself. One only has to follow the path. But you guess I need something too. I know a way out. I show you. And you help me out of here. I cannot die in this cage. Finally, progress. Griff releases me if he sees I do not have what he misses. You must find who steals them. After I am free, you are free. I see no one. In fact, I only hear the sound of Griff clearing his throat. You know how he does. Like so. For some time, I think Griff takes his own supplies. But I see the anger in him that he does not find it. He truly does not find what he seeks. Griff is a powerful man. Power is mysterious, in case you haven't noticed. Thank you. And hurry. Please.
This looks like the crates I'm after. But where are the contents?
Just as you're about to address the lizard, the Red Prince bars you with an outstretched arm.
This man is a dreamer. As you know, I need a word with him. You may wait here while I speak. Permission indeed.
He bids the dreamer stand up and pay attention, which he does in a groveling and awkward manner. The dreamer then chews and swallows a handful of Drudene leaves before slipping into a trance-like state. He falls asleep. To your surprise, the Red Prince lies down and follows suit. After about half an hour, they wake up and begin to discuss what they saw in their dreams. The Red Prince pinches the bridge of his nose in apparent irritation before turning his back on the jabbering dreamer. You receive a withering glance in response.
A deserved bit of sarcasm, I suppose. But though this stingtail fellow may be a less than stellar specimen in the firmament of dreamers, the dreams themselves prove to be quite elucidating. Turns out I'm being hunted by an enemy I didn't know actually existed. The myth-shrouded House of Shadows. The dreamers, though, they're on my side. And they've visions of me on the throne. Of course it is. I was born with the promise of an empire, and that promise will be kept. But to keep it, I must find a second dreamer. A greater one. A more experienced traveler of the dream world. Bahara is her name, and she resides in the swamplands east of the fort. So, let us make our escape and venture there post-haste.
You know, I could tell you all about swamp dreamers too.
Huh?
What? But I was... It was... Please, tell me. Tell me. Why did you wake me? I was so close. So close. And you smell of burnt hair and barren dreams. But I had the good breeding not to mention it. Oranges. Is that what he told you he's missing? Well, I suppose it's technically true. Though I'd guess Mr. Griff is more upset about the Drudinae than the citrus. The Drudinae Griff cleverly smuggles into the prison, of course, stuffed inside the oranges. You don't think he'd really be so mad over a little missing fruit, do you? No, it's not the oranges, but the dreams he's after. Same as I, though. I have the right, the responsibility. It may be hard for you to understand, but my kind, we dream for the greater good. What we see can predict the truth, can even shape the truth. But we need Drudinae to do it. Before I was caught, before I was brought here, I saw a vision. The void woken, slain, divinity restored. But just as I was about to see how it happened, the Magisters beat down my door. This is my last chance to find out the secret, to find out how to save us all. So you see, I cannot give back the Drudinae, not only for myself, but for all of us. My dreams are my gift. They may be our salvation, too. Blood. And it won't be long before he'll have it, with all his thugs lurking about. They'd stick me in my sleep if they knew. Fine, fine, take the Drudinae. I'll find more. Another way. Somehow, I have to, for all our sakes.
Griff glances from his blade to you and back again. Griff tears into one of the oranges with both hands. Juice squirts through his hands as he desperately rips through the rind.
Looks like everything's accounted for. Now the important question. Who's the thief?
This Griff is nothing but a thug. Don't give up Stingtails so easily.
I don't want Stingtail's blood on my hands.
Griff would kill a fellow over petty theft. Giving up Stingtail is no better than murder.
I'm right chuffed to have my supplies back, so I'm gonna give you one last chance. Tell me who you found them on, or you're gonna have to answer to me, my knife, and each one of my people. And your little elf friend won't make it out alive, neither. Must think I'm playing with you. I don't play, and I'm over. Thank you.
yourself!
You're not trying to escape, are you?
is mine.
Thank you.
Well done. Sometimes, the best way from a situation is the simplest. I hope Griff rests in peace, even if he lives in anger. You helped me. You saved me from a terrible man. But still there is more I ask of you. I know a way out of here, and this I tell you. But there is something else. Sahela, she is everything. A ruler, a seer, a knower, a child. She cannot be lost here. I have nothing here, but where the elves roam, I think there is nothing they do not give. Give me your map. I show you the way out. A secret. Dangerous. But it leads to freedom.
I give you this amulet. You must pass it to the elves who still remain. Tell them Sahela is here. They will send help. Please. She is important. I go to her. I wish you good luck, and I thank you for us all.
You come to fight. You come to prove yourself. You come to be worthy. There can be only one, and you have but one chance.
She scoffs.
To prove you are the one. Never mind. The one does not ask such a question. Good. Who aids you? Choose wisely. Whether you fail or succeed, you do not fight more than once.
I've waited this long. I can wait longer.
Thank you.
ready.
I need aid! are not the one. Pity.
The one will walk among us, though not today, it seems.
I'm the only one with a gun.
The creature heaves through lips gummed with human gore. It turns to you with great effort, pain apparent in every movement, and madness screams from its wide, bloodshot eyes.
You. Quite lost. Careful, or they'll cross your wires. Now, a little query. Where grows the yarrow? Quickly now, for I haven't much time. Now, or didn't you hear me? Where grows the yarrow? Dire, and for you too, if you want to keep your top screwed on and your wires in a row. Do you hear me? Where does the yarrow grow? Where?
Prepare.
The dead man, creature, thing, lies in a heap on the beach.
Whatever it was too dangerous to be allowed to live.
Maybe there was something to his obsession with Yarrow. Perhaps it means some spark of his personality remained.
That might be what happens to sorcerers here. But I'm not hanging around to find out for sure.
Single name throbs across your brain. Verdas, Verdas, Verdas. He must escape. He cannot die here. He cannot. As the dead man's flesh slides down your throat, you feel his consciousness enter yours. His memories are yours to experience. You are Finn. Your heart is heavy. You know too much. It's all too much. You met him. A bright light blinds you, then fades. You feel a tremendous power in your hands, but they are shaking so hard you can barely use them. Suddenly you're on this very ship, crouched in a corner, hugging your knees. A figure approaches, an older woman. Her eyes are kind. She comes closer. She says she wants to talk. She reaches a hand toward you. You grasp it. The memories end. You are no longer Finn. You return to yourself with a jolt. You cover your face with your hands. You've just heard the news. The elven homelands have been destroyed by death fog. It was your order who did it. How can this be? You eat Griff's hand, and you see him putting animals, dead for days in the blistering sun, whole into his cooking pot. Probably best to pass on the stew.
Walk is never done. Unless everyone's dead, of course.
The man sleeps so deeply, he might as well be dead to the world.
You love your bell, my...
Hope you gave some thought to what I said. It's a mi- I brought my own share of...
soon.
Will thoughts change back? What if there are no sorcerers left? Yet so quickly.
So, what's the news? Well, I certainly got lucky with you, didn't I? The way out's nice and secluded. It starts in a little hidden alcove on the beach.
Give me your map. I'll show you where to go. And hurry, not a tick of the clock to spare.
I've spotted something.
Thank you.
creatures. Tooth and claw, humans and lizards, fighting since the dawn of time.
In the back. Follow me.
I wonder where this leads.
As the alcove opens up, you see the same skeleton that you met on the boat before it sank.
He's leaning over a corpse, prodding and pulling at the skin of its face. Bugger.
How on earth am I supposed to... Oh. Perhaps?
Skeletal fingers reach down and grip the skin of the dead man's face, pulling sharply upwards. After a few more tugs at the man's cheeks, the skeleton relents, letting the head drop to the ground with a damp thud.
Damnation. That stuck fast. I wonder...
Ah!
No! Stay back! Don't... Oh, it's you. I must admit I'm surprised. Perhaps you're more buoyant than I suspected. It seems the human that stole my mask was rather more resourceful than I gave her credit for. I chased her here, but she rather seems to have given me the slip.
He turns back to the body, prodding at its face cautiously.
Why, its face, of course. What other use would I have for some rotting corpse? A face that seems rather stubbornly attached to his skull.
I would normally employ a tool to delicately, but viciously, rip the face from the body.
I could then craft a mask to hide my bone. But as I lack such a tool...
The skeleton grabs the corpse by the cheeks and pulls hard, grunting in frustration as the body's skin holds firm.
Carved? Please. You hardly think I am one of your breed, do you? You have never seen anything like it because you have never met anyone like me.
Simply put, I am an Eternal, and you are not. You have my sympathies.
Indeed, no one seems to have the good taste to be. My people are rather absent.
At least from this realm. As for the others, well, there is an excavation site at the Black Pits oil fields. Perhaps there I'll find my answers.
A cult? Hardly. We were a race that existed before the idea of race was needed. We were all one. I could ask you to imagine an Eternal as a creature of incredible intelligence and skill. But I fear the limits of your imagination would not do us justice. We studied the mysteries of the universe. We created works of great art. We disappeared. But I will find them. Wherever they are, I will find them. We will have our world again.
Yes, yes. Do feel free to call. By which I mean shout loudly. I do not want you sneaking up on me again.
Thank you.
is she? You go with us. Who are you? Are you from the shelter? She says nothing of another. Fire, alas! She is so late! A magister offers to help us flee. A Tutor. She says there are many magisters who do not agree with the bishop. She says they bring us to safety. But a Tutor is overdue. She promises to come at noon. We are afraid to stay, afraid to leave. I see. I see. We hope for nothing then. We wait for nothing. I like to be alone now.
You hear a small whimpering sound from behind a basket. You peer behind it and find a small human child holding her knees and trembling. The child quiets and seems comforted by your presence. She looks up at you with curious eyes. A wide grin cracks across the child's face through her tears, showing two big gaps where her front teeth should be. She laughs.
Really? Yeah. Warrior Princess Coral. You're nice. You can have this. I found it outside, but I can't read it yet. That's next year, and then I'll learn it.
The child wipes her eyes and, grinning, plunks herself down on the earthen ground. She starts tracing shapes, hearts, stars, and diamonds into the dirt.
They're transforming.
spiral of vines snakes upward from the corpse. After a moment, you realize the gruesome truth. They're not entangling the corpse, but bursting from it. The vines have split the corpse's chest with incredible force. Thin roots wriggle from limbs and nail beds, anchoring it to the ground. The vines encircle a rough depression, as if something held there was violently torn free. Before you even registered the cool flesh, the vines lash around your wrist and drag you close. They pulse, tightening mercilessly, and release you, withdrawing sluggishly, as if sated, for now.
Sir, we've got company.
Ah, planning an ambush with this scion, were you? The witch don't fool me. She's wrecked this ship by herself, with a collar on.
I tell you, I am no witch. The spores do this. If I do not find the rest...
Store the elven hedge magic. Weren't much use when we flooded your forest with death fog, were it? Lucian said it was a necessary evil. Me? I was just sorry we didn't get the lot of you.
You? I try to give you a chance. More than your divine order give mine.
Ossa, her armor!
The scion twitches in sudden rage, and her armor uncoils as if made of living vines.
No more chances.
I've got a new spit for you to chew on.
mine.
murmurs, stroking her armor as if soothing a wild beast. It is incomplete and made, it seems, from the vines themselves.
The spores grieve. They wish only to create, not kill. This is why they grow armor from the vines, do you see? To protect me.
It is the Magisters who destroy, who separate the spores, anger them. They are creation magic, old enough that even we Scions forget. I find them, hope they can restore the ancestor trees lost in the war. But the Magisters chain me and send my spores away, for study, and in wrong hands.
She gestures at the entangled corpses, vines still spattering gore onto the deck.
No. You speak like a Magister. These spores are meant for life, not death. The armor is alive, and I sense it wishes to be whole. Perhaps then it truly speaks as the ancestor trees do. I find its spore mates and see. You help enough. My armor guides me now, and it is eager to be gone. I hope one day you visit my homeland, where the ancestor trees bloom once more.
As the knife lances into your thumb, deflected neatly off one of the rough-skinned spores you and Thews took from the prisoner. A wet pop behind you, Thews on his knees, his spore cracked and smoking in his hand. Thin sprouts push from beneath his eyelids, his nose, his mouth, his screams choked beneath a single vibrant thistle blooming from his throat. You move to help your friend, but stop short. It's the elf woman, crouching behind Thews with her chains broken. She spits a phrase, Khmer Doran. And you are choking, the spore boiling in your hand as gas blinds you. You feel something stir in your chest, then shift, then tear.
Swallowed too much seawater by the looks of him.
Foolish to attempt an escape by sea in these waters.
Elf uses her palms to wipe away two steady streams of tears.
Do you know the homeland? I wish to take my little one there, but there is nothing left. There is nothing left for us here. There is nothing left for us there. There is nothing left.
I salute you, Puss.
That's where we're going to end here for tonight. Hope you all enjoyed, and pleasant evening.